Would you like to know the biggest mistakes people make on their cloud architect resume or solutions architect resume? If so, this video is for you. In this video, I will discuss the most common mistakes people make on their resume and the jobs that it keeps them from actually getting. And your resume matters for this reason. Your resume is kind of a marketing document about you. Your resume pre-sells you to the world. It will guide how people will see you. It will guide the interviews you actually get. And an optimal resume is really a key to your cloud architect career. And I have reviewed over 10,000 resumes over the years. And I can tell you there's a common set of mistakes that people make on cloud architect resumes and solutions architect resumes and security architect resumes. And I don't want you to make any of those mistakes because I want you to have an incredible architect career. So one of the first things we can see, and it happens all the time, and I'm going to tell you it knocks out 80% of the resumes I receive, is when we have what's called an obvious fake resume. Here is the obvious fake resume. We've got a chief information security officer at a company nobody's ever heard of because it's the person's own LLC, or a principal architect working at a two-person company that they actually own. So when we see something like that, it's a fake resume. We toss the resume aside. The other time and ways we spot fake resumes are in the person's job that they've actually written up things. They have together things that don't go together. So it makes us understand, or at least believe, the person doesn't even know the things that they're putting on their resume. I'll give you an example. Here is something I found on a fake architect resume. I know for a fact this person's never worked as an architect, but they're actually out there teaching architects. And here's what the person put. Architecture design, deployment, and capacity and performance planning of deployed frameworks. So why did I know that was fake? Because a framework is basically a guide that says step one, say, look at the business needs. Maybe step two, look at the organization's business architecture. Maybe step three, look at the organization's data architecture. Maybe step four, look at the organization's technology architecture. And it's a step-by-step way to do something. What you don't do architecture development and capacity planning of deployed frameworks. You basically have an architecture that exists and you need to adapt it or create new architectures based upon the business needs. That is completely different. And that's why when I look at this, I can see it's obviously fake, and every employer can too. Now, the next one is really a confusion about a cloud architect role versus a cloud engineering role. Both are very important sets of people, but their jobs are so different. And many times candidates have their jobs stuffed with cloud engineering, and it doesn't show the person as an architect. So if you're conflating or confusing the difference between the two, you actually have a problem because it either looks more like a fake resume or it shows you that you're trained with the wrong skills. So cloud architects focus on designing solutions to optimize business performance. Cloud engineers build and implement technical solutions. So if what you have is all about you coding all day, that's fine. That's cloud engineering or software engineering. And again, that's fine if that was your job. But make sure that your job is not all about those technical specifications. Your resume needs to show some strategic thinking in your technology. So you weren't just building it. You were either designing it, you were planning it, you were leading or mentoring something. So if you come from a bit hardcore tech background, then that's fine. It's great in some ways. Make sure you pull out the leadership, pull out the presentation skills, pull out the meetings, and pull out the impact of what the technology that you worked on did for the business. So if you created a new website for a global retailer and it increased sales by 1%, that could be a potentially a big impact for a new website. So especially if it's a large organization that's got a large top line revenue. So you need to be able to show the business context of everything you're doing. If it's all about the tech, it's engineering. It's what the tech did for the business, resume showing architecture. Now, the next side of things is really all related to that. If it all looks techie, it looks very engineering. So make sure you've got metrics. At the same time, if you've got no tech on your resume, you don't look technically competent. So show knowledge of technology, show knowledge of applying technology to solve business problems. So show knowledge of being able to talk about the end-to-end overall solution and what it did for the business. And have metrics. How did it improve efficiency, for example? Did it reduce cost or operational cost at some place in the business? What new capabilities did the technology design for the business? Now, more about that is the overuse of technical jargon. Again, you want to show competency, but if you've got a whole bunch of acronyms and you've got a whole lot of jargon on your resume, it's going to get your resume tossed aside. So here's the reason for this. Somebody has to be able to pick it up, be able to read it, be able to see what's in it for them to want to interview you and or hire you. And if it's full of technical jargon, it's going to have a hard time to actually read it for the person to read it to actually get the information. And that is the problem, because you typically have less than 5 to 10 seconds for someone to read your resume before it gets tossed aside. If they can't find why they should interview in that 5 to 10 seconds, well, let's face it, they don't bring you in for an interview. So it's full of technical jargon. It puts you in that challenging position where it's just going to be there. So strike a balance between demonstrating technical knowledge and your communication skills at the same time. The next thing is you should have a good executive summary or professional summary at the top of your resume, and here's why you need it. You have 5 to 10 seconds maximum to get someone to say, I want to read this resume a little more. So the executive summary is what's in it to sell the reader to read more of your resume, get to know me a little better. So if you don't have that and it's not compelling and it doesn't make you look good, nobody's going to read your resume beyond that. So make sure it shows the hiring manager what's in it for them to talk to you and or potentially hire you. Now, the next thing I hate to see on a resume, and it usually turns me away from dealing with the person, is an objective. Many times people put an objective on the resume, and that's what they want to get out of the job. Well, this is not the time to ask for anything. Look, if you wanted to sell an expensive product, you don't put the price of it on the website. You have a beautiful website, and the person contacts the website, and it says, leave your information, and someone from the sales team will call you. And then they will show you the product's value. Well, they'll get you to fall in love with the product, and then they'll give you some scary high price, okay? Now, I want you to sell yourself like a high-priced product so you earn more. So the key here is, don't ask for anything on your resume. Show them what you can do for you. Get them excited to bring you in for that interview, and then wow them in the interview to the point where they love you. Now you're that expensive product that comes with that super scary high price, your expensive salary. So the next thing is your resume somewhere along the line needs to be easily readable and easily organized. If I can't look it up and look at it and say, okay, that's an architect. Yep, the architect stuff, let me talk to them. And I can't do it in that fast, it's over. So cluttered resume doesn't get read, especially in many cases that people are reading them may need glasses. It may not even have glasses that are reading the resume. So look at that. It just has to be easy to see and easy to read. Maybe somebody's looking at it on a phone. Imagine that. So just think about has to be quick and easy to the point. Clear, easy to read. Now, the next thing sounds relatively minor. And when I was young, it used to frustrate me. And as I get older, I learned more ML and I can see why it matters. And this is spelling errors, grammar errors, and tense errors. Here's why it actually matters. When I get a resume full of errors, it shows me the person lacks attention to detail. Because if they cared or they put the attention to detail to it, they would have gotten it right. And then I worry. If the person doesn't have the attention to detail to be able to show themselves well and put a little love and care into their own advertisement about them, their resume, what's going to happen for my clients? Are they going to have the attention to detail to my clients' need? So I typically need someone with a good degree of attention to detail in an architecture role. And if they're spelling, grammar, or tense errors, it doesn't look that well. And is that person going to be delivering grammar-written proposals to my client and make the organization look bad? So these things matter. So if you're not the best spell check person in the world and you're not using AI, get a good grammar checker. We all do. Especially at the elite level, you write something, it goes to professional editors anyway. So just take the time to make it all exactly good. And the next thing I caution you on is to try to overly dress up your resume with things you can't explain. So we're in a world where people are telling people use AI to match your resume to the job description, and people are now custom tuning resumes to job descriptions. And a degree of customizing your resume to a job description is excellent, where you talk about your actual skills and things you've actually done in the context of how it would be relatable to someone like them. That's great. But what most people do is they put things on their resumes they can't explain. And yes, that often gets that person the interview. But what does it really do when the person comes and passes that interview? First thing I do is interview them. I ask them about something on their resume they can't answer it, and then the interview is over. So even if they got their resume in the door, they won't get hired on the interview. And that stops 80%+ of interviews. So don't do that. I strongly don't recommend it. Find a way to explain what you can do and explain your value to the organization and show them what's in it for them to hire you. Say your resume, your cloud architect resume, your solutions architect resume is a key part of your career strategy because it pre-sells you to the world and it shows others how they will see you, and it'll guide what interviews you get and the opportunities that are coming your way. So spend some time to build yourself a great resume. I know we train everyone on how to build a resume, build a LinkedIn profile, and interview anybody that we would ever train, because it's part of the key to building yourself a career. But no matter what, build yourself a great resume. If you're looking to become a cloud architect or an enterprise architect or an AI architect or a security architect, join us for a free webinar. There's a free webinar that we hold each week in the description of every video. Go sign up. It's on Zoom. It's free. We'll talk about the careers, talk about the skills, and you can ask us any questions live on Zoom. We also have a lot of free ebooks to assist you in your technology career in the description of this video. Please check them out. Go sign up for some free ebooks, and I hope they help you a lot in your career. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. Please subscribe to our channel and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to help you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs signing off for now, and I hope to see you on another video soon. Take care.